Morning, saints. Amen. Let's open our Bibles to the Gospel of John, chapter 6. As you're turning there, we encourage everyone, every time you come to worship the Lord and listen to His Word preached, to open your Bibles and look at the Word and study the Word. We don't want you to take our word for it. We want you to test things. We want you to be Bereans. That's why we send sermon notes out. And a brother sent a link this week to a sermon. Clint prayed about it in the 8:30 hour. And I'm going to just take 2 minutes. This does not count as part of my sermon to address this, though. That's right. Don't start the clocks yet. This is free time. But listen, we don't just gather here on Sunday morning, open up the Word of God for a pep rally. We're coming to God's Word this morning because we believe this is God's Word. We believe that man does not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. We believe there is transforming, life-giving power. We believe that we need this. And listen, it's encouraging when you're preaching the Word of God to see the saints engaged, to see them in their Bibles, to see them nodding their heads, to hear amens. That's encouraging. It's really encouraging afterwards to hear people speak about the sermon or the Word. But there is a concern pastorally that Phil and I have. And I'm going to borrow the words from this sermon that I listened to this week because it was good. He was doing a comparison about those of the Puritan age and those of modern age Christians, genuine converts today. And he was speaking about something that's been lost that we desperately need to regain. And that is meditation on the Scriptures. Saints, it is not enough for you to merely read the Word and show up on Sunday and hear the Word preached and say amen. Those are necessary and good. But what takes us from being hearers of the Word, doers of the Word, and therein glorify God and be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ is meditation upon Scripture. Listen, there's no shortcut. This is the prescribed biblical means of conformity to Christ, at least one of them. And we, as a people, born-again Christians, yet still influenced by the culture, have bought into this quick-fix stuff. And I know we have so much going on and we're so busy, but one of the ways we need to discipline ourselves and discipline our bodies is by meditating upon Scripture. Tell me it's not true that by this afternoon, 90% of what I stand up here and preach today will be gone from your mind. It's true. It is true. And it's not because you're a bad person. It's because we're bombarded with so much. Some of that we allow in that we shouldn't. But I don't want you just to say amens. I don't want you just to be encouraged, although I do want you to be encouraged, but I hope the encouragement would take you from here, being hearers, back to your own home, opening up to John chapter 6 this week again, if necessary, maybe because of distractions, maybe because of children, that you listen to the sermon again, you get a piece of paper out, you read through it, you prayerfully ask God to help you, and you meditate upon the Word, and you say, God, show me and change me by your Word now. It won't happen just showing up on Sunday and listening. It just won't. You'll get a little bit. The reason we don't preach 5 sermons a week, and I'm not against anyone who does, is because I know we don't meditate on one of them. So what would 5 do for you? Listen, it takes time, and I know we're busy with good stuff. But this is something we need to carve out our schedule for and prioritize. Let me exhort you lovingly this week. 2 hours this week. You're going to have to give up something. 2 hours this week. Not because I think my sermons are good, because I think the truth of this text is what is needed. 2 hours this week, you go back maybe two different times for 1 hour, and you sit in a quiet place, and husbands help your wives help your husbands here, and maybe you listen to the sermon again. Take notes. And then approach it prayerfully and carefully and examine yourself and ask questions of the text. And then meditate upon it, thinking about it, considering it, weighing it, examining yourself in light of it, and see the difference. Just see the difference. See if God would reward what he calls you to. He will reward it. And if you're born again, your desire is for his glory, and your glory, his glory is there for his glory, and his glory is in your conformity to Christ. And that comes through meditation. So please, just try it this week. Try it. See what would happen if you spent two more hours meditating upon the sermon. See how much more you see. See how much more it's at the forefront of your mind, that when temptation comes, you are armed now with truth to fight it. And see if God does not bless that. He will bless that. And it's hard work. That's another reason why we don't do it a lot. It's just hard work. We're a right now, this minute society. If we get the little hour clock on the computer screen for 5 seconds, we're irritated. This is going to be different. This is what we might call old school. And so, to borrow the pastor or preacher's words, he said this, something like this. The difference between the Puritans and modern American Christians is this. On Sunday, when the preacher said amen at the end of his sermon, for Christians today, that's the end of the sermon. For the Puritans, it had just begun. It had just begun. So may the Lord help us in that. Okay. Let's pray for that. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, God, we come, we have spoken of Christ already. We've prayed, we've confessed, we've sung. We come again, Lord, feed us, teach us. We've sung that song before, show us Christ. A greater revelation, we pray for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Jesus. That we may behold your Son, Jesus. We may see him and live in light of it. God, save the lost among us and strengthen those whom you've graciously saved. Capture our hearts by your Spirit. As the word goes forth, what is true, capture it in the hearts of your people. And do, God, help us to see the importance of meditation. Let us, in that sense, be countercultural. A people who get away alone with God and seek your word and your face. And reward those. Your word says you will reward those who diligently seek you. We believe that. And so let your people, as they pray this week before they meditate, let them pray in faith with expectation that you will answer that prayer and help. Glorify your name in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Okay, we're in chapter 6, working our way systematically through John's gospel. In chapter 5, Jesus was in Jerusalem. He healed the invalid on the Sabbath. He made claims of equality with God. He gave testimony to as why those claims are true and should be believed and embraced through faith. Now, why didn't the Jews in Jerusalem embrace Jesus? He told them truth. He did miraculous signs in front of them. He gave them testimony through John the Baptist. He gave them other testimonies as well through his works that he is God in the flesh. He is the Messiah to come. Why didn't they embrace him? Because they love the glory that comes from man. They love the affirmation and praise of man. See, the cost was too high. They love themselves. They love their sin. Listen, it wasn't due to lack of knowledge that those Jews did not embrace Jesus Christ. It wasn't due to lack of evidence. He gave them much evidence. It was due to a lack of spiritual life. It was a heart issue. He said, "You won't come to me because you don't want to." It was a will issue. It was a heart. It was an affection issue. They love something greater than Jesus, namely themselves and the praise of men. They were dead in their sins. They were unable to come, and they were unwilling to come. They're slaves. Today we're going to be in chapter 6. Just like chapter 5, the struggle is we really should preach the text, the whole chapter in one sermon. We really should. But we're only going to do 15 verses. But what I'll be doing through the entire chapter is looking forward in the chapter, and as we get in the middle, I'll look back a little bit. So we'll be doing this because we don't want to lose the big picture of the chapter, namely the forest, as we look at the smaller pictures of the trees in these first 15 verses. Before we read our text today, let me remind you again the purpose of why John wrote his gospel. This is important that we keep reminding ourselves of, because we come to the text, we need to be asking, how's this being fulfilled? The whole book of John is written to this end. So when we come to a text, we say, well, how does it fit into John chapter 20, verse 31? Because that's his goal. We're working backwards from the goal. What does it say? These are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, he's the Messiah, the Son of God, he's God incarnate, and that by believing you may have life eternal in his name. So John, by the Holy Spirit, is putting before you things and leaving out other things that he is trying to work to this goal. This is his object. This is his desire as he goes through the text. Let's read verses 1 to 15. Follow along with me. After this, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. And a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" And he said this to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. And Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. And Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, filled the baskets with fragments from 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. And when the people saw the sign he had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." And perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. Verse 1 is the setting. After this, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. As you're reading through the Gospels, remember, you're not getting a perfect immediacy of chronology here. It is going chronological and the events as it's unfolded, but it's not necessarily like, okay, they did this and the next minute they were doing this. In fact, there's a gap of time here between chapter 5 and chapter 6. One of the ways you can figure that out is by reading the all the different Gospels. So as you're reading this account here, you'd want to go back and look at the other Gospels, if they write about it, and ask, what do they say about it? Which they may be looking at it from a different perspective or trying to help you see something else in it, and they may give different details to help you fill in what's been going on so far. This is interesting. This is the only, other than the resurrection, this is the only miracle recorded in all four Gospels. Must be pretty important if it's recorded in all four Gospels. Here are the references. This week, maybe in your meditation time, go back and read the other gospel accounts. Look at the other details that are going on around this. So we are going chronologically as we go from chapter 5 to chapter 6, but it's not immediate. It's not like what we just finished over there with the Jews and now we're stepping right here. There's things happening in between. What's happening in between? I think it's important to give you some concept here of what's going on so we can get the context. Here's what's happening in between. Jesus has sent out the 12 disciples. Remember he did that? He gave them authority and power, and they go out to proclaim the kingdom of God, and they're healing people. So they're out doing this. You can get this in the other gospel accounts. This is what's happening. And while they're out, they learn John the Baptist has been beheaded. Herod, remember his brother's wife's daughter danced for him, and he liked it. He said, what do you want? And she says, give me the head of John the Baptist, and cuts off his head and brings it to her on a platter. And so that just happened. The disciples are finishing this going out to preach the gospel, healing all around. They hear about John the Baptist. One of the synoptics records, they go bury John the Baptist. And they're coming back to Jesus now, telling him about what's been going on as they've been going out, but also letting him know, hey, John the Baptist is dead. Remember this, Jesus is fully man, and he's fully God. You have to keep both of those in view when you read about Jesus. Think of what just happened. His cousin, John the Baptist, who he probably knew growing up and was the forerunner for him, has just been beheaded. Think there's any emotion going on? Jesus has been serving, acting. The disciples are worn out by going around healing and preaching the gospel. They're just heavy. They've just buried John the Baptist. They tell Jesus about it. In fact, I think it's in Matthew's account of the gospel. Matthew says that Jesus went to be alone by himself for a little bit here. Gives you some insight to what's going on. In Mark's account, it says that Jesus says to the disciples, and they tell him about John, he says, come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while. It says that they didn't have time to eat yet. So they're tired, they're exhausted, their friend is dead, beheaded, persecution. A lot's going on. And I think it's important for you to have that context because we're going to see what we can draw out of what happens next here. So they're going, they get in the boat, they're going across the Sea of Galilee to a desolate place, just get alone, to rest, maybe mourn about John the Baptist. And what happens? A large crowd was following him because they saw the signs he was doing on the sick. So get the picture. Jesus, disciples are wearied, hungry, mourning, wanting to be alone. I'm sure we've all been there. And this crowd of people, as they're sailing across, they're just running around this side. So when they get to the desolate place, they're there. And he knows, look what it says, why are they coming? Because they saw the signs he was doing for the sick. He already knows the hearts of all men. Remember that? He knows their motive is to use him. I had a conversation about 2 weeks ago, maybe three, with a man who God has blessed financially very much. And he was talking with me about it. And he said, Jesse, it's very hard. And I said, what? His family's lost. And he said, I know my family just wants my money. My kids couldn't care less about me. They're waiting for me to die. They have no interest in me. They have no love towards me. They're just using me. They just want my money. They don't want me. And he went on to say, in fact, they're just waiting for me to die. Being used like that. This is where these people are. They couldn't care less about Jesus. They just want him to do stuff for them. Do the miracle stuff, healing stuff, feeding stuff. We'll see later. Deliver us from Rome stuff. We don't really care about who you are, though. When we use you, keep that in your mind. They're exhausted. They're tired. They're mourning John the Baptist. They're trying to get away to a desolate place. Here comes this crowd of people following them, and they don't care anything about them. They just want to use them. How would you respond? How would I respond? How does Jesus respond? Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. So Jesus gets off the boat. He goes on to the hill country here. The disciples are with him. They sit down. That's why he wanted to get away with the disciples. Here comes this crowd of people there. Let me give you two more insights here of how Jesus responds to these people who are coming with ill motive when all these people are tired, want some rest, and want to mourn. How does Jesus respond? Look at Mark's account. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. That's hard. You know what that's called? Love. Love. You know who this isn't about for Jesus? It's not about him. He did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. You know what I find utterly disturbing in my heart? Is that if anyone should have come to be served, it's Jesus Christ. Anyone's worthy to come to be served, it's him. And he comes to serve and give his life. If anyone should not come to be served, it's me. And yet I find myself wanting to be served so often. I find myself upset when I'm not getting what I want. Luke gives us a different insight as well. Look what Luke says. He welcomed them. He wasn't like, man, I'm so tired. I'm mourning my friend, John the Baptist. These people, they're just going to use me. Get them out of my house. Let me rest a little. He didn't murmur. He didn't complain. He welcomes them. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Love is kind. This is what this is. It's a welcoming, especially when those who you're welcoming don't deserve to be welcomed. And believe me, these people, we'll see by the end of the chapter, they don't deserve to be welcomed. They're in it for what they can get out of it. And he welcomes them. And he spoke to them about the kingdom of God, the gospel. And what else did he do? He cured those who had need of healing. I mean, look at this. Look at this demonstration of love from Jesus Christ. There's a lot to be gleaned here. It is not wrong to take a break. It is not wrong to guard break time. Something I need to learn better. But there is something here to be gleaned from Jesus who, when his plans go awry, meaning he wants rest, but the Father's will is not rest, it's to welcome people who want to use him, to heal them, and to preach the gospel to them. He doesn't complain. He just loves them. What an example. What an example we have in Jesus Christ. Now, maybe when you're growing up in Sunday school, you heard about Jesus feeding the 5,000. And you think, Jesus fed 5,000. We'll see it's probably closer to 15,000 to 20,000 people. He fed all these people from these 5 loaves, 2 fish. What an amazing story. What an amazing story. What an amazing story. It is an amazing story. But it's a sign. And one of the things we did probably or heard growing up is the extent of that teaching we got growing up is Jesus can feed a lot of people with a little bit of bread and fish. And we go, amazing. And we should be amazed by that. But this is a sign. It is not something that'd be an end unto itself. It is pointing to something else. It is affirming something else. And what is it affirming here? It is affirming that Jesus is getting ready to lay a theological foundation, a theological setting regarding redemptive history. And you know who's going to be at the center of it? Himself. These people are still looking to Moses. They're still looking to rituals. They're still looking to temples. And he's getting ready to lay a theological foundation in this bread where he's going to help them see something greater than the bread of old has come. Something greater than Moses has come. Something greater than the temple has come. Something greater than Elijah has come. And something greater than your stomachs just being filled with bread has come. The bread of life has come. So let's be amazed at Jesus feeding all these people. That's a miracle. That should say something, but let's not just stop there and applaud the miracle. Let's say, what's the miracle pointing us to? It's pointing us to Jesus Christ being the bread of life, the fulfillment of redemptive history. And Jesus is going to lay that out for us here so we don't just miss the whole thing that's being taught here. Okay, verse 4. Now the Passover feast of the Jews was at hand. Okay, this is significant here because what's the Passover about? Do you remember? What's the Passover about? The Passover is pointing back to when Moses led the people out of bondage and slavery to Egypt, right? They're enslaved there. And the final plague is that the angel of death is going to go through the city and kill the firstborn. And in order for that to pass over you, you have to kill the lamb and wipe the blood on the lintel of your home. And then it will pass over you. The judgment that's coming will pass over you. So this is happening at the time of the Passover by no coincidence, but by the sovereign will of God, because Jesus Christ is the Passover Lamb. And didn't John the Baptist already bear witness to that? Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So it's not just, oh, what a coincidence, this has happened during the Passover. No, this is important. When they come out of Egypt, what are they going to eat? Some bread. What's he going to feed them? Some bread. What's that pointing to? The bread of life, deliverance, not just from Egypt, but from sin and slavery to sin. A lamb who doesn't just deal with that Passover of the angel of death, but deals with the judgment to come, which Jesus just spoke about in chapter 5. So, this is significant that he's dealing with all this right now. Verse 5, lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat? Now, if you go back this week and you read like Mark's account, John doesn't give us a lot of detail here. John makes it kind of sound like he's sitting here with the disciples, this crowd just walks up and he just feeds them. But Mark's account says he was healing them and he had been teaching them. They've been here a while. It's not that he just walked up and he said, let's feed these people. Remember, they went there, they came, he taught, he healed, now he's going to feed. John's account makes it look like they just walked up and he fed them. So get the other accounts and get some more details as you read through that. But he asks Philip a question here, and does he just, Jesus not know something that Philip knows? I mean, Philip, if you read his account, they believe he's from right around this area. Does Philip know of some source of food in the area because he knows the area better than Jesus, and then Jesus needs to find out how to feed these people? No. But why would he ask Philip a question? Something we can do here and something I can learn here, something dads, you can learn here. Jesus was a perfect teacher, and he would often just ask questions to find out where people are at, to find out what they're gleaning. So men, as you, Lord willing, are teaching others or your home, and again, something I'm needing to learn from, ask questions so we can have discussion, so you can know where people are at, so you can rightly help them. So Jesus isn't asking Philip because he doesn't know the answer. Verse 6 tells us why he's asking it. He said this to test him, for he himself, Jesus, knew what he was going to do. Jesus already knows what he's going to do. He's asking Philip to test him. And so I want to stop here for just a moment, and literally a moment here, but I think this is important to recognize this. In each of our lives, Jesus already knows what he's going to do. They're planned out. But he is often testing us. How about always testing us? Here's the question. What is he testing you in, and what is he testing Philip in? Faith. That verse came to mind. He often does this through providential difficulties, bringing into your life things, situations that can't be resolved by you in your own little weak power. He's often asking you, maybe situationally, what are you going to do here? What are you going to do here? Why does he do that? Because, we're going to get to this in chapter 15 of John, salvation in Christianity is not just being saved from hell and then getting to go to heaven in the end. It is about total reliance and dependence upon Jesus Christ every second of every day. We call that in John chapter 15, abiding. He's testing Philip here to see if he's going to look to Jesus. What are we going to do, Philip? I don't know. What are we going to do? Money? I don't know. And he's often asking you, what are you going to do here, Yoon? When no one in your family's believing, what are you going to do? You going to figure it out on your own, or are you going to turn to Jesus Christ and say, you alone, you have the answer. I'm looking to you. I'm hoping in you. My trust is in you. I can't do anything. It's all you. You got to do something. You got to act. That's what he wants you to do. And when you do that, listen to me, he acts. And then he gets the glory. And that's why we've been created. So, situationally, your life is being thrust, like these disciples here, with circumstances that don't have a circumstantial or physical answer. How are you going to persevere to the end, moms? You're overwhelmed now. It's only going to get harder. What are you going to do? You can't go on. Just too much. I'm underwater. I can't breathe. How are you going to make it tomorrow? Just look within inside and find strength within yourself and build yourself up in self-confidence and make it through today through positive thinking. That's the world's philosophy. Or just abandon it all. Just go off and leave everything. That's another philosophy. Or turn to Jesus in utter weakness and find that there's power in weakness. That's the Christian's way. Confess your weakness. I can't do it. There is no way that we can feed 15,000 people here, Jesus. There's no way I'm going to make it tomorrow. There's no way I can resist temptation to sin on my own. There's no way I can keep loving these imperfect people who keep offending me. You ask me to keep loving them. How am I going to keep loving them? By the power of Jesus Christ. How are you doing in that answer in your life, which comes literally every day? You turn into Jesus? Or is Jesus just what gets you out of hell and you put him on the shelf and you say, I'll see you at that day. Here I go living my Christian life now. Jesus is not just the savior of that judgment that we read about in John chapter 5. He is the savior of that judgment day. He's a daily savior. Daily, over temptation of sin, over selfishness. He rescues you from that every day when you're looking to him, eyes upon him, abiding in him. That's what this is about. That's the test. Are you looking to Jesus, or what are you trusting in? And I want you to know this, God the Father lovingly will prune your life of every other thing you're trusting in. He will lovingly do that. He will prune you of everything else you're trusting in. Oh, I'm good for tomorrow. I got $1 million in the bank. He will lovingly remove that from you. Oh, I'll make it tomorrow. I'm strong. He will lovingly take your health from you. I'm good. I got my spouse. Don't say it, but yes, he will. There's no extent that God would go to keep your eyes on Jesus and keep you abiding in him. None of it towards you in any form of wrath, all of it in love, but all of it to conform you to the image of Jesus Christ. And what did Jesus say in John chapter 5? I can't do anything. Everything I do, I look to the Father, I hear from the Father. I don't do anything of my own. He's bringing you and I to that reality. I can't do anything. It's all, I look to him, and whatever he says, I do. That's where he's bringing you and I. You know, one of our greatest problems is that we so often misinterpret what God is doing. We believe the whispers of Satan say, see, he's against you. And we go, yeah, he is against me because that doesn't feel good. When in reality, he's showing you love by giving you what is best, which is bringing you to total dependence upon Jesus Christ. How does Philip respond? Let's look. Verse 7. Philip answers him and says this, well, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get a little. A day's wage is one denarii. So 7 months of money wouldn't even get these people a nibble, he says. So let me ask you this. Where did Philip's mind go when he was faced with an impossibility? He went to circumstance, and he went to his own power and his own abilities. Well, we can't do it. Why? I don't have the power to do it. I don't have the money to do it. And I'll tell you this, I'm convicted that so often when presented with these situations, I look at my own strength and power and I either try in pride to do it and fall on my face, or I look at myself and I say, I can't do it, so I just sit down and quit. And both responses are wrong. How should we respond to these situations? Well, let me show you the next verse again. The next verse, Andrew speaks up and he says, well, one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, well, there's a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they for so many? Philip, 200 denarii, I wouldn't even give these people a crumb. Andrew, there's some fish bread, but what is that for these many people? What are they both thinking? Circumstantially. What do we got to work with here? What are neither of them thinking? That Jesus was the one who just a little bit ago sent them out to heal diseases. That Jesus was just the one a little bit ago who went up to the invalid, another impossible situation of 38 years, and said, hey, take up your mat and walk. They've forgotten about that Jesus. They've forgotten about the Jesus in Cana we read about when everyone ran out of the wine and he turned to the waters and he said, there you go. All of those were impossible circumstantial situations where if we look at the limited ability within or circumstances here, they're impossible. It's over. 200 denarii, won't do it. A little bit of bread and fish, won't do it. And standing before them is Jesus Christ. What should their response be? How are we going to feed him? Philip, Andrew, Jesse, how are we going to feed it? How are you going to get through this? You're how I'm going to get through it. The one who saved a wretch like me. The one who took this sin-loving, God-hating man and took out his heart and put in a heart that makes me sin-hating and God-loving. The one who redeemed me from the wrath I deserve. The one who did turn the water into wine. The one who did heal the invalid. How are we going to do this? You're here. What do you mean, how are we going to do it? See, that's called faith. It's faith. How are you going to overcome sin? You. Your finished work in the power of your Holy Spirit. How are you going to love your wife? You. You loved me. And by me growing in greater revelation of your love, I lose sight of myself, and then I'm free to love others and not think of myself. That's how I'm going to love my wife. How are you going to go on another day? You. Listen, it's not look within and build up self-esteem, beloved. That is such a worldly philosophy. It is confess your weakness and acknowledge who it is who lives in us, the one who upholds the universe. How many times have you been convinced of your circumstance? Well, it's impossible. Let's give up. I mean, daily maybe? And we read earlier that he sustains the universe. Yeah, you can't handle my situations, Lord. It's a faith issue. Do you see that? It's a faith issue. So they're not responding well. Even the disciples are not responding in faith well right now. Another reason why that he does work through the loaves and the fish, because Jesus could have said, like when he created the world, let there be light, and he spoke and it existed. He could have done that here. But he works through the fish and the bread, and a lot of commentators say they believe he does that is because Jesus is continually pointing these people not to look back at the Old Testament figures, but to look at them as they point to him. And one of the people a lot of people look to is Elijah. And in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 42 through 44, Elijah, if you were to read the account, he feeds 100 men with 20 loaves and there's some left over. That's a miracle. It's pretty impressive. But what Jesus is saying by feeding through 15,000 people through 5 loaves and 2 fish with 12 baskets left over is this. Hey, one greater than Elijah's here. One greater than Elijah's here. Remember Elijah, the one you guys keep pointing to? Yeah, he pointed to me. I'm the substance of what he pointed to, standing before you. So maybe go read 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 42 through 44 and see why maybe Jesus worked through the loaves and the bread here. Verse 10, Jesus said, have the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Now think with me, what does Jesus have before him? 5 loaves, 2 fish. If you read about the types of loaves, barley loaves are the loaves of the poor. It's not like a loaf of bread, it's like a wafer. And 2 sardines kind of thing. Not that it would matter if it was the biggest loaf of bread, it's 15,000 people here. But get a picture here. Before them still, there's not a means physically to feed all these people. But Jesus now, acting in faith, says, tell them to sit down. Because faith has legs, you know that? Faith walks. James says, faith without works is what? Is dead. I believe, I'm just not taking a step. Okay. Do you really believe then? Because before Jesus, there's still nothing to feed him yet, but he says, come and sit down. We're about to eat. Have you ever read George Mueller's accounts? One story in there where he built the orphanage, children sitting around the table, cupboards are empty, and they sit down for dinner. And what'd they do? They prayed and thanked God for the food. What food? Mueller said, God will provide. Let's pray and give thanks. And they sit down and they pray for the meal. I can't remember the story exactly. Maybe it was the milk truck or the milk wagon, whatever it is, breaks down in front of the orphanage and says, our milk's going to spoil. Can you use some? Yep, we can use some. What is he demonstrating? Faith. See, faith acts. It doesn't say just my God can, my God will. My God will. Now before you think I'm turning to health, wealth, and prosperity, I will tell you this. God will when it's according to his will. Meaning, James says you don't have because you don't ask. And when you do ask, you spend it on passions of your flesh. That's why you don't get. So what are you saying? I'm saying that if you ask anything in the name of Jesus Christ according to the revealed will of God, he will answer it. And if you've let the health, wealth, and prosperity nonsense rob you of that, you're in trouble because you need a lot every day. So are you saying that if I want to glorify God and I can't see how I can go forward another day because I'm so underwater, that if I pray, he'll enable me? Exactly. But pray with faith, believing and expecting, and he will answer that. You're saying that I'm so afraid to even talk to anybody, but for the glory of God, not so that I'll look good, but I want to go out and proclaim the gospel because I know I'm called to the Great Commission, that he will take a weak, feeble, stuttering tongue like this and give me power to advance and call and preach the gospel? Yes, he will. He will do that. He always answers that prayer. In the name of Jesus, according to the will of God, is answered. He'll give you the power to love unlovable people. But you have to come and ask. Because that's that dependent, abiding relationship thing. Because in the end, who gets the glory? Not the poor, stammering fool, that's us, but the one whose power is working through us, that's him. That's him. Have the people sit down, he says here, acting in faith. John 14:4 says, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Jesus acting in faith, knowing that God the Father hears him because he always acts according to the Father's will. He tells the people to sit down, and the minute he's going to give thanks for the food, and they will partake. How can he be so assured? Because he knows God, and he knows the will of God. And beloved, the more you know God, and the more you know the will of God, the more you can ask according to the will of God, and the more prayer is answered. The more prayer is answered. If you want to look in Matthew's gospel, you can see here that those who ate were about 5,000 men besides the women and children. Not that if it was just 5,000, it wouldn't be a miracle, but it's more than 5,000. It's a whole lot more than 5,000 that are getting ready to eat. Verse 11, Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted, and when they had eaten their fill, he told the disciples, gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost. So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. So note this, Jesus gives thanks to the Father. Remember, Jesus the man is sustained and empowered, not by his deity while on earth, but by the Father through the Holy Spirit. You got to keep that in mind as you read this, okay? So Jesus gives thanks to God for what he's going to do. God's going to work this through his power through Jesus, not by Jesus's deity, but by God's power working in and through him. Here's something else here. Jesus allows the disciples to distribute the bread. You get that out of Luke's account. John's account looks like Jesus did it, but in Luke's account it gets more detailed that they sat down, Jesus gave to the disciples first, who then gave the bread to the people. I think there's something in that. Namely, that Jesus is the bread of life, but he works through people. The disciples had no faith. I don't know how we're going to do this. I don't have enough money. And we struggle here with faith, and I'm not condoning it. But here's what's so amazing to me. He still works through them. You know what else? He still works through imperfect you. I'm not saying take it easy on your lack of faith, but I'm saying look at the kindness of God, that he works through these broken instruments. Isn't that amazing to you? We're called to distribute the bread. It's called the Great Commission. Jesus is the bread. Let me tell you your job, okay? You're like a waiter. You know what a waiter's job is? To take the food and get it to your table without spilling it or changing it. That's their job. To get it to the table. We don't get to change the food from where we got it in the scriptures and make it more culturally palatable. Hey, let's dumb down this Jesus stuff. He's a little holy. Let's not talk like that. That doesn't sell well. That's not your job. Your job is to take what is given to you, the bread, the gospel, as it is, and bring it to the people and call them to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. That is your job. That is my job. We are to take the bread to the lost world without changing the message or dumbing it down or making it culturally relevant. Can I say something real quick before 15,000 people are following Jesus? At this point, and modern day church growth strategists would love Jesus up to about right now. And in about a few verses, they would hate everything Jesus is getting ready to do. Because if you read to the end of the chapter, these people all leave him. So right now, modern day church growth strategy, which is just about how many people we can stuff into a building for the appearance of success and to keep the machine running. How do they do it? They change the bread. They take it and they change it and make it palatable for the people. You're going to see what these people want here. They want a king on earth to deliver them from the Romans. And modern day church strategy would say, give it to them. They'll come for it. I'm sure you received a lot of bulletins in your mail this week about joining other churches for Easter. Pathetic. Not that I'm better, but utterly pathetic to sell Jesus like that. I'm not against Christians getting together. I'm not against our children having fun when we gather. But I'm not going to peddle the gospel. There is one message and we don't change it. The gathering of the saints is not about bounce houses and eggs. And if you want to go do bounce houses and eggs tomorrow, I don't care, that's fine. But you don't try to lure people in through the feeding of the flesh. Because once you go that path, beloved, listen to me, the moment you compromise and you go there to look successful, you got to keep feeding the flesh to keep them. Because all you're drawing in are God haters. Now, I'm all for reaching the lost, but it's not through making this more fleshly appealing. When someone says things like, the lost people love coming to our church services. Listen, people should love being here because they feel the warmth and love of Jesus Christ. That's true, but they don't want to worship Jesus. And we're going to see it by the end of this chapter when he begins to share about who he really is and what this whole salvation thing really looks like. Namely, election. They scatter. When you preach the true Jesus, only a born-again, regenerate person embraces him. If the lost world can embrace your Jesus, you've got the wrong Jesus. They may take a piece of him and like that about him, like these people like, I like your healing. I like your feeding. I like the idea of you being a king right now and removing the oppression of Rome. Oh, I like that. Holiness? Yeah, not so much. Repentance? No. Self-denial? Mm-mm. I don't want any of that. God keep us from that. 12 baskets left over. You know what else that points to? The sufficiency of Jesus Christ. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Beloved, in Christ, you have every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places now. Do you know that? That's Paul's prayer for the church at Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 1, that they would grow in the revelation of who they are, united to Jesus Christ through faith. He's saying this, the problem with you right now is you don't understand who you are in Jesus. And I pray you grow in the revelation of that. That's his prayer for them. And then live in light of that revelation. 12 baskets left over. Jesus Christ, sufficient. I'm trying to hurry. Verse 14, when the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, "This is indeed the important word, prophet who is to come into the world." We spoke about this before when people referred to Jesus as the prophet. That's a reference to Deuteronomy chapter 18. Do you remember when Moses stood up and said, "A prophet like me will come and you need to listen to him"? This is who they think he is. And some of them actually believe it. They see what he's done. They go, "Oh, he's come from God." Kind of like Nicodemus. "We've seen the deeds you've done. We know that you've come from God." So they have enough teaching to understand people can't do this kind of stuff. 5 loaves, 2 fish don't feed 15,000. Something's different here. But they don't know who he is, and they don't love who he is as he reveals himself to them. So some of them have enough knowledge here. This is a reference to Deuteronomy chapter 18. You can go read that again. We already talked through that, so I won't go there again. But what are these people thinking when they see Jesus and they get excited about this, the prophet to come? Look at verse 15. Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. So they see the miracle. Wow, he's healed us. He's taught us. He's fed us. That's amazing. We like that. This is the prophet to come, but they don't realize what that prophet really is. But they do understand enough to say he's supposed to be a king. So what do they say? "We love that you're king. Come be a king right now and get rid of these Romans for us. Make our lives better." See, they don't love Jesus for who he is, the king of the universe, God in the flesh, Messiah. They just want to use him for their own little kingdom. And Jesus knows this, and he says, "Nah, I'm not having any part of that." Now, if Jesus was part of the church growth strategies of today, he would say, "Okay, I found something they like, and I can get rid of these Romans, and I want to grow this big church, so I'll be your king, and the Romans are gone. And look how big the church gets so quickly." But Jesus is not here to cater to the praise of man. We learn that in chapter 5. He is here to do the will of the Father. The king will become a servant. He will suffer and die in their place. They don't want to hear that. They don't like that. They don't like suffering king stuff. We like kings who make our lives better here on earth. That's what they're saying. So they can't deny Jesus' works. They recognize, like Nicodemus, he has come from God, the prophet. But they fail to see their own great need. It's not redemption from the Romans. It's redemption from sin. So they want a Savior who will give them what they want. You ever see people changing Jesus today? A lot of people talk about Jesus today. It's just not the Jesus of the Bible. It's the social justice Jesus. It's make me rich, Jesus. Take all my problems away, Jesus. But when you say, "No, that's not the Jesus of the Bible, this is the Jesus of the Bible," they reject that Jesus. They don't want that Jesus. That's what's going to happen here at the end of the chapter. So like so many people today who claim to love and follow Jesus, these people want Jesus as Savior, but they want him under their terms and his way. We like the idea of Jesus, this man that can heal sicknesses and feed our bellies and deliver us from Rome. Listen, you don't have to be regenerate to like to be healed from diseases, have your bellies full, and have no one in authority over you. The unregenerate love that. But to want the kingdom of God to come into your heart and to your life, and to die to yourself and live to Christ, you have to be regenerate to want that. That's what Jesus is getting ready to tell him here in a little bit. The more they learn about who Jesus is and what he came to do, they will turn from him, proving their faith and following of him was not genuine in the first place. Listen, beloved, Jesus did heal the sick, but he primarily came to heal from the greater sickness, which is sin, through his death, burial, and resurrection. Jesus did feed them bread, but he primarily came to give himself as the bread of life, to rescue them, not from physical hunger, but from spiritual death. Jesus is king, but primarily he came not to deliver from political oppression, but to establish his own kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. They don't love that Jesus. They reject that Jesus. This is the Jesus of the Bible. And I want you to know this. He is a mighty, mighty Savior. We're going to pray, and then I'm going to bring up Stephen and Stephanie and ask Pastor Phil to join me as we celebrate their birth coming up next month. So let's bow, give thanks to the Lord for his word. Stephen and Stephanie will join us, and then we'll sing about our wonderful Savior. One more exhortation. Please go home and meditate. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you for Jesus Christ, the fulfillment of everything in the Old Testament pointing forward to him, God. You have so blessed us in Christ. Lord, continue to reveal to us a greater revelation of our Savior. Let us embrace him, Lord. Let us reject any using of Jesus, any lack of faith towards him in our life. Let us embrace him for who he is. We need your help in that. Draw your people into communion with you this week, Lord, through private meditation, and take us from being mere hearers and affirmers to doers and glorifying your name, God. Do a work in our heart. And if any are lost among us even now, God, let them see the sufficiency of Jesus Christ, fully God, fully man, and the sufficiency of his work through his death, burial, and resurrection. Let them believe that if they confess Christ and repent of their sins, they have eternal life. Thank you, God. In the name of Jesus, amen.